friends, it'd be a great pleasure to discuss the right to education with you, and I intend to use this talk to talk about this right as a somewhat different kind of right, even though we include it in the list of fundamental rights. But there are several factors which perhaps will succeed in making us all realize that this is no ordinary fundamental right. How I intend to go about this is by looking at the act which makes it a fundamental right as a text, and read into this text the larger picture of the system, which is the handle or the instrument through which this right is to be realized. So my method is going to be of seeing how this text can reveal to us the different goals which the state and the legislature have attempted to reach by enacting this act. So in a way, we are doing a kind of discourse analysis, though not in a detailed sense, but we are trying to see the way this act has been composed to make sense of the nature of this right and the kinds of issues and problems which this very major step of passing this act attempts to address. If you look at this act carefully and see how complex it is, and compare it to similar acts in other countries, for instance, our neighboring country, China, which is a much simpler act. Or if you look at the successive laws through which Britain realized the goal of compulsory primary education, or compare it with almost any law of this nature, you will be struck by its complexity. And already within these last few years, the complexity has hit both the government and the judiciary through the few cases that have come up through the various levels of the judicial process. The act has proved that it's quite complicated. Why is it so complicated? My answer would be to suggest that the act is trying to reach more than one goal. Let's look at them one by one. The first goal it's trying to achieve is to fill up what I would call a policy vacuum. Not in just the sense that, yes, the current educational policy we are following is something already about 30 years old. Not in that sense, but generally in the sense of any kind of broader guidance for the state. There is a vacuum if you're looking for that broader guidance. And this act kind of fills up that space and attempts to serve as a policy document. Well, it attempts to serve as a policy document which the central government in a somewhat federal system that India has would like to fulfill. A role that the central government has assigned to itself. So you can see the text as an attempt to take the advantage of concurrency, which was endowed on education during the emergency, during the constitutional changes which were brought about during the emergency, giving the center a role to play area, which was then called education, now is called human resource development. Otherwise, if you go by the original constitution's own language, you would have thought that the center had very little role to play, which in fact is still a fact, that even though there is a Ministry of Human Resource Development, this ministry has very little role to perform, because much of the decision making implementation and even policy making is done at the state level. And between the state and the center, education, school education is one of those areas where power lines have been very blurred and very confused. And for that reason, for decades, at length, you can see, even some very basic issues have not been settled. Consider, for example, the length of primary education. Now, primary as a word, this act tries to transcend. It creates a new stage, a palpable stage called elementary, which can be broadly subdivided into two, primary and upper primary. But on that subdivision itself, there has been this tremendous diversity of practices and opinions in India. Many states, including the biggest states, have had 4 years of primary education, whereas many other states have had 5 years of primary education. And so the total length of elementary education has varied. In some states it's 7, in some states it's 8. And so there is a, there has been, and there continues to be, this kind of lack of systemic coherence and uniformity, which is not merely a matter of numbers of years. That for the only reason one would dismiss it as a nominal kind of problem. No, it's not nominal. It's a substantial problem. And that comes also into view if you look at the text of RT, you will see how many things it's trying to address by overcoming this issue of the difference between who is a teacher in the primary stage and who is a teacher in the secondary and at the upper primary stage. And in a way, the Act also tries to address yet another set of states, like West Bengal, for example, where after primary, actually secondary education begins. The notion of elementary didn't exist in Bengal and many other states, in fact, within British India, if you look at primary and secondary, where the category is used, and the idea of elementary is a relatively new idea. And so if you look at how decisions are made in states like Bengal, you will realize that it's the Board of Secondary Education which prepares curriculum and other guidelines for the primary stage. Now this Act is attempting to create a coherent language which is kind of being broadcast from the center, a language which the Act asks the states to follow from here onwards, creating a stage called elementary, which will have 8 years of free and compulsory education for all. That's how the Act speaks. And even though the emphasis is on the compulsory nature of this period of education, and the hope that it can be given free of cost, nevertheless, the collateral meaning has to do with the number of years, and let's all accept that it's a stage that lasts for 8 years, and that this period of 8 years can be best understood by first having those 5 years, which we call primary, and then having that rump of a stage, which no one has ever been clear about, and we'll get into that complexity in a short while. The upper primary stage, 6, 7, grades 6, 7, and 8. So that's how we come to these age groups like 6 to 14. Now that itself is an interesting debate in India, has always been what is the age of entry, what is the appropriate age of entry for a child for formal schooling. And on this matter, now there is, although the Act has been passed and various states are busy readjusting their systems to the discourse of this Act. Nevertheless, grey areas persist, and the greyest of those areas is in what happens before age 6. And you know that there was a lobby which is still quite active, which says that this Act is not adequate because it doesn't cover what they would like to call 0 to 6, as if education were possible at 0. But anyhow, discourses are quite imaginative in our country. we have to concede that yes, people have a right to free speech under another fundamental act, right? So we have a situation where before age six, the act is kind of not silent, but it doesn't endow on children less than six that fundamental right. All it says is that it uses the language of Article 45, the language which earlier used to be used for school education. This act uses that language for children below six, namely early childhood education, shall be provided by the state to the best of its capacity, kind of a directive principle. Now, we can also see this act taking the place of a directive principle, which is what it does. And in that sense, it's a hesitant act because a long time had elapsed since the framing of the Constitution. And this long time, obviously, was a time which gathered more and more embarrassment for the Indian state because the state could not fulfill its own aim, even though it was given a directive principle in the shape of Article 45. Like many other social sector goals, this goal too was not achieved and was pushed from year to year, decade to decade. And we can discuss in our exchange of questions and ideas later on what made it possible for the state to finally do it in this period of late 90s and early 2000s. How did this consensus emerge and so on? But the difficulty of this consensus, creation of this consensus through the legislative process, is partly written into the discourse of the Act, the way it disperses responsibility and authority, creates many levels of authority, addresses various kinds of schools, including central schools and private schools, and levels of governance through which the school system functions. You can see that the Act is, in that sense, feeling positive about it, you can call it very nuanced. Otherwise, you would have to call it a fairly difficult act to implement, given the nature of the allowances it makes for a very complex system that it acknowledges and takes it as a given. So even though the Act attempts to fill up a policy vacuum, and in that sense reform the system, by creating more coherent language for the system to function in, even though it does that, at the same time it accepts in the complexities of the system and treats them as sort of a given, and doesn't quite remove all the edges which make the system so cumbersome, so inefficient. Another aspect of the vacuum which it tries to fill is the vacuum pertaining to notion of standards. Last 15-20 years, that has been the major discourse in policy making in our country. Namely that it seems that the state is fairly close to achieving universalization of at least primary education, if not elementary education. However, now this discourse emerged during the late 80s and reached its crescendo during the 90s. And since then, we have been hearing more and more this kind of clamor. And some people use this clamor to debunk the state, saying, yes, the state is increasing numbers, it's enhancing enrollment, but it's not able to address quality. And a lot of people and institutions use this kind of clamor, this opportunity to favor greater role for private agents in the system. The issue of quality, indeed, is a very major discourse. And one is a bit surprised when you see this act speaking of very difficult, subtle, almost liquid kinds of issues of quality in the language of law. And you wonder, why does it do that? Should a law address pedagogic issues? Should it forever enshrine a certain kind of correctness about one kind of pedagogic approach? In fact, many educators have raised this question, why this act privileges activity-centered learning or no detention policy and very specific technical or professional kind of decisions in the field of education? Why does it privilege them over other possibilities? And in the last couple of years, especially in the last 1 year, and if you must have heard this very, very loud political demand for no detention policy being scrapped, and the demand that the system should revert to a policy which provided for a board examination in grade 5 and the end of grade 5, another examination at the end of grade 8, and so on and so forth. The Act, its language, attempts to address these subtle issues, professional issues, you might call, by stating what kind of education would be worth having for children. If they had a fundamental right, what would it mean in terms of their educational experience? So that in the language of the Act, you can read that great backlog of discourse in policy, which has persisted for decades, in fact has persisted since early 20th century, that progress in elementary education has been nominal in the sense of enrollments. And these larger issues of what happens when a child gets enrolled, when the child is actually attending schools, what kind of life does the child have, what possibilities of learning do different children have in the school. Those issues, the policy, by and large, sort of avoided addressing them directly. For the first time, perhaps some movement you could witness in the 1980s when this term child-centeredness entered policy discourses, but didn't get all that much clarity and emphasis. What does it mean to have child-centered education? Even the program of action, 1992, did not provide many parameters. Curriculum frameworks did not do that until 2005 to some extent. The framework which NCRT prepared in 2005, in its chapter 2, for the first time attempted directly to address this question. What does it mean to work with children? Who are children? Who is a child? What is it? What is our notion of the child and the child's learning? And how does it take place? Well, you can see it in a very positive light, that this remarkable law takes up this difficult responsibility of defining education as an experience and set out a few statements, fairly bold statements, which may not be easy for the judicial process to handle. But yes, under imaginative fingers, perhaps someday, we could say that yes, my child is getting education, but not of the quality that this Act wants. Yes, there are very remarkable statements about how curriculum should be organized, how testing should be reformed, what must a teacher do when surrounded by children. And more than anything else, it provides for a space which the central government has used and which the state governments have also now used to create some norms of infrastructure and also some norms of pupil-teacher ratio. These norms have never had much attention, even though these two massive programs of the 90s and early 2000s, namely District Primary Education Program, DPEP of the 1990s, and Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan that followed it, both tried to create some norms of infrastructure. Not that it was never done before. In the 1950s, such attempts were made to say, what would you call a school? Is it just a building? Or should the building have certain norms, certain spaces, certain standards which you can follow? Well, in the good old days, even the PWD had a sense of norms. But from 1960s onwards, a certain kind of chaotic expansion prevailed. And successive governments could only add rooms, one more room, two more rooms, so infrastructure could be treated as some kind of an agglutinative process. On adding some sort of ramshackle building could be declared to be now adequate for a school up to grades 5, 10, and so on. Similarly, in the middle of the 1980s, Rajiv Gandhi insisted on this national policy on education. It was succeeded by an Operation Blackboard, which tried to create those norms. to say, well, you need a room of this size to call it a classroom. You need a room of this size to call it a storeroom for a school, or a land covered area of this kind to call it a room. Well, those norms could be easily flouted, and they were. Now, under RTE, you can see that this policy vacuum is also being filled up, in the sense that RTE is accompanied by a set of rules which it demands, and the central government has created model rules, and on the basis of those model rules, state governments have been in a way pushed, literally pushed, to create their own model rules which they will follow to achieve some degree of accountability as to against what standards should they be judged. They have had to declare certain rules of infrastructure, of recruitment of teachers, of pupil-teacher ratio, and so on and so forth. And these are the areas in which the Act tries to fill up a policy vacuum, which tells us the story of a highly neglected area of welfare state's responsibility, a major area of social development, which our country has neglected at a very heavy cost. That cost cannot be calculated. What have we lost by neglecting the education of the children for such a long time? That calculation perhaps can never be made. We are where we are in terms of various development goals which national bodies have set, certain goals that we ourselves set. We are not in a good picture either in terms of defining childhood, in terms of health standards, nutritional standards, or in terms of learning standards and so on. So this Act attempts to plug that hole. And this is where I come to my third major reading in this text. Not only the Act fills up a policy vacuum, creates a discourse which we can all share on occasions like this to talk about the system of elementary education. In fact, the Act tries to also fill up a social or cultural vacuum. It attempts to create what I would call a social construct of childhood. Childhood in India, go by reports and writers, scholars, childhood in India is a concept which is just about, you can say, just a bit beyond the biological concept. We understand the child in terms of a small human being, vulnerable. But as a social construct, the journey of childhood, this language of citizenship, has barely begun. One says that simply because one doesn't know how to describe the child. Given the various parameters that human history, countries which have had a social construct of childhood for a longer time, if we look at their history, we will pick up those parameters. For example, a child is somebody who is protected. Somebody who is not compelled to work for a living, whose body is permitted to grow in a manner that constitutes a sort of a natural potential. Now these are the kinds of things you will read when you look at, say, John Stuart Mill talking about liberty in the later 19th century, a philosopher who made childhood capable of the basis of dignity in citizenship. Now, if you measure by that kind of historical standard, you would be struck by this feeling that we are nowhere close to having a social category called the child. The diversity of conditions in which India's children live, from abject laboring poverty prevailing in abject laboring conditions, to child prostitution and child trafficking, and absolutely remarkable levels of malnourishment. We have barely controlled a very high IMR within all that period. But we haven't actually moved much beyond infancy. Indian childhood is still very, very vulnerable. and by covering the modality, we have probably moved a year ahead of infancy. But then, if you look at those other laws that cover child marriage, laws that cover child labor, there's progress in the fulfillment of those laws itself speaks the story. That child marriage is not merely a problem in a state that we would associate with feudal values and conservative ideas like Rajasthan. It's a problem in Bengal as well. Where else would you like to go to see a contrast of Rajasthan, either in terms of political ideology or stability of governments? Bengal had 30 years of a stable government. Go to the south, you find child marriage statistics. Now that brings me to this very difficult issue of gender. Because when they're talking about childhood, they're talking about not just boys, they're also talking about girls. They constitute childhood. Do they? Do girls have a childhood? Well, the question begs for the idea of girls as a woman in the making is so deeply entrenched in the culture that it's impossible to not see it as a major sort of shadow over the notion of acceptance of girls as children. A woman's instrumentality as a reproductive biological member of society is so well imprinted on culture, on social life, on economic life, that it's not surprising. It's something that so many studies have shown now in anthropology, social anthropology, and so on, that right from birth onwards, girls are actually being imprinted to become small women. Yes, in some cases their childhood may be a bit prolonged, but by the time the girl is 9 or 10, her life is very seriously curtailed if you compare it to boys or generally against any standard of childhood. That kind of cultural inheritance has been compounded by current trends which we thought would liberate India girls. But in fact, their instrumentality is now receiving a new dimension under the global regime of produce capital, where the girl is an enhancer of entertainment. Or women themselves now are part of a major entertainment industry, which attempts to treat them as people who make life interesting. I mean, look at, for example, women's role, young women's role in IPL. IPL itself is an entertainment type of industry, cricket. But then, the idea that you could use girls to dance each time somebody has a six tells you something deeper about the text of girlhood and womanhood in society. I invoke all these very images in brief simply to tell you that the notion of childhood will have considerable difficulty in getting made into a social category because of the problem we have with girlhood for various reasons. And this is not the occasion to dilate on that subject. And those who are interested can see my most recent book, Churi Bazaar Menraki, which is about girls' upbringing and their childhood in various parts of various sectors of society. But yes, the attempt RTE makes, the right to education bill makes, is to fill up this cultural vacuum, a discourse which is yet to flourish. The attempt is to create a semblance of a gender feature and to create a space where we can talk about boys and girls and where we can see what kinds of needs they might have there. For example, the act attempts to prolong childhood, which is itself a very big question. A lot of people are still calling this primary education a kind of related law, which it's not. It's an attempt to prolong that period of childhood which the Act tries to bring under institutional care, and thereby the creation of an elementary stage. Now, we can't stop at 11, we stop, we go up to age 14. Now that transgresses into that age, precisely that age when girls lose their childhood, age of early puberty, when concern for their future, especially their matrimony, is so deeply implanted into the culture. And in that sense, you can say party has that echo of having to function in a society in which girls don't have much of a child. Bengali, for example, childhood is called actually Chhayabara, which is boyhood. And if you look at Hindi, look at various other languages, images of childhood, literature, cinema, various other sectors, you will find images which are much more fitting on boys. For example, we would all like to believe that in these grades, like say from grade 2 to grade 6, what is the big thing that happens in primary schools? That is, children explore wider and wider spaces. They learn to ride bikes, they get lost, they like to hide from adults, and that is how they assert their growth. Now, we know exactly these are the grades in which girls lose their conquest of space, and they learn to become much more accountable. And the girl grade 5 is not seen in the school for even an hour. It can be a matter of very serious concern, as opposed to the boy who is seen as truant, and the same would be applicable to home. The attempt to prolong childhood by making it come under the purview of institutionalized care of a civilized society is very clearly, you can say, written into this law, and in that sense it's a progressive law. I would conclude this brief talk with a short section which talk about how one sees this moment in our history. We are aware that this act has taken almost 100 years to be enacted. I date the attempt from 1911, when Gopal Krishna Gokhale had put in the first draft of a free and compulsory, we call it primary education bill, in the Imperial Legislative Assembly, 1911. And Gokhale was careful and right. He knew the controversies which were raging in Maharashtra, and so he confined that bill to boys. And even then, that could not get through. In the Imperial Legislative Assembly, it's not the white British who opposed it. Many Indians opposed it. Those included people, large pieces of land, and one of them, Raja of the Banga, very openly said that we will work in our fields, prices of grain will grow up, we will work so much that poor people will not be able to eat if you don't allow child labor, and so on. So the bill didn't make it. The idea of having universal compulsory free education could not get through the Constituent Assembly either. The idea that the state did not have the capacity, or between society and state there will be a skirmish on the issues. Society which is primarily agricultural, where children work, fields, and so on and so forth. All of those debates of the Constituent Assembly remind us how difficult this area proved for otherwise people we call our progressive founding fathers. When it comes to childhood, our fathers came up. Take us to 60 years later, 90s. India's growth rate begins to increase. It seems that certain conditions came together. There was pressure from the international donor agencies, and it seems as if India itself was a bit embarrassed about the social sector record. Yes, there was an NDA government which wanted to achieve something at that time, and managed to achieve this constitutional amendment, which required massive consensus. But then many more years had to pass after 2000 for a proper bill to come, and that took the best part of UPA 1, could not happen. It happened in UPA 2, and as soon as it happened, problems began, and within 2 years the bill was back in the Supreme Court, and again now it's back for people who are showing dissent with this or that clause and want to improve upon it. Now, as a under the concurrency law, states can improve upon that by actually going back upon it. State of Rajasthan, for example, has already drafted a bill which attempts to amend that part of RTE which offers no detention policy. Rajasthan bill, if passed, in the state of Rajasthan, will provide for a board examination once again and will give the fear of failure as the main reason why children should study hard. If this bill is passed by the Rajasthan Assembly under concurrency law, it will have to be approved by the president. And let's hope that the president will at least get it examined. Why so soon after a major law was passed by India, after 100 years of delay and dilly-dallying, it should be amended so quickly. But many other states are similarly planning to put in state laws which will partly adjust this law to their own conditions and needs. In the name of those conditions, this very progressive law can again set it torn apart in a way. We are at a very special moment in social history, a new chapter of social history. In this new chapter, we are, many of us are quite naturally feeling very impatient. And you can see how many NGOs and various other institutions are already paying for the state, saying nothing has happened in these 5 years since our serious forgetting it, and so on and so forth. Not enough money is being given by central states, and various other ways in which the idea of RT is criticized within such a short time. Given the fact that it took a century to enact, I think this social history will definitely take a much longer time for it to become a reality. And if we were serious about understanding society and not simply the state, we would have to acknowledge areas of conflict between state and society. In a colonial society where the state emerged under colonial conditions, these areas of conflict are very significant and serious. For example, the state, even if it wants to, cannot easily successfully ban child marriage or delay the age of marriage, even though it's happening at a very, very slow pace. If you go by census records since 1881, you have some reason to feel something. But it's also an area in which one can understand the constraints under which the state works. And so, in this social history that this Act has inaugurated, I would like to say that all of us have very, very sensitive roles. By all of us, we mean teachers, we mean institutions, we mean investors, we mean state players, and more than anybody else, the judiciary. In fact, when I got this invitation, I felt very pleased that the National Law University had seen fit to spend an afternoon talking about children through this law. It's an unusual law. I don't think lawyers of the future are going to find it easy to work with, and judges will have trouble interpreting it. And perhaps it will go through many a stage in interpretation when its paradigm is fully opened up. 5 decades perhaps of judicial interpretation. Especially those clauses about quality will take a long time to unfold. Areas where authority is defined will prove particularly difficult. It's a law which is about a very special right, and this is my last point. This is a right given to somebody who cannot by definition be aware that he or she has a right. This is a right that we hold on behalf of somebody. In that sense, it's a proxy right. It's a metaphor of a right. It's really not a right, it's a metaphor. It's a metaphor that reminds India's adult society of a certain burden it carries, a burden of a backlog, and a certain burden of conscience, which it still doesn't have, towards its children. Who would you compel to this right? We say free and compulsory. But it's an interesting thought. Who does it compel? Perhaps it compels the state to recognize its own responsibility, because it clearly doesn't compel the parents. Something that a lot of people resented when the bill was passed in Parliament. A lot of people thought that parents should be compelled. But there are others who believe that parents who are already being compelled to live in subhuman conditions cannot be compelled further. Send their child to school. So somebody has to tell us, what does the word compulsory mean? Now, free is another interesting term, that you are imposing a certain kind of freedom through compulsion, unless we treat that word free purely as a statement of financial investment. That free means it will be without cost. To whom? The child is not paying any cost either. For the parent, there will be a certain cost anyhow, especially if the child has been working for parents. So it won't be free in that sense. But perhaps the free is itself metaphorical. It means that we will be a nation with some more freedom that we can claim. So many years after freedom was politically achieved, by giving an education which we will say, well, it doesn't curtail on a child's freedom. At least in that metaphorical sense, we will say, yes, we are giving to the child something that the child will freely want to have, hoping that the school will be less oppressive than his or her life at home, or in the neighborhood, or on the railway station. The bill is very, very demanding. It's almost like a dream. It's a fantasy. And in that sense, it's a very unusual law. It's not close to intervening in social reality by any stretch of imagination. Anybody who understands India's domestic economy would know that this bill is going to be not just going to be a challenge, it's going to be a major problem to understand, to interpret, and to take forward. And yet, it's an exciting, progressive bill, which I've said to you opens a new window of history, and we're all going to be participants in that history. Thank you.